Up next on the Tower Sessions is Johnny Gleeson. Johnny, I am really looking forward to hearing your set. I've known you for an awfully long time, and I know how good your musicianship is. What is it that got you into the style of music you play?
Well, when I was very young, I used to babysit for my brother Timmy, who was a fine guitarist. And he used to have all these Chet Atkins albums, so I used to babysit for him. And I used to play Chet Atkins because he was always my hero, always, always. And then I used to try and play it, which I couldn't really. I used to make the Irish attempt at it. And then some years after, I was playing guitar in bands and so on like that, and I was over in Walter Hennessy's music shop.
I know him.
Yes, you do. Yes, you do. And there was a Dobro, a resonator guitar, hanging up on the wall with all the other guitars. And I stood there looking at it for a while, and he kind of noticed, and he said, you know, that might suit you, the way you play and so on. So I bought it, and I brought it home, and I looked at it for a while. And I thought, oh, no. This is going under the bed now for the next 20 years. And then I went up on the net, and it was like instruction videos and so on like that. So I did a few, and it started to open up a little bit for me. And eventually I became completely hooked. And I just love the sound it makes. The sound is just really something. And I've been kind of smitten by it ever since. So I keep playing. Now, I didn't play for 2 years. I developed a frozen shoulder. So I'm kind of back since the lockdown. Mm-hmm. Playing again, you know, and I'm really enjoying it.
Excellent. Yeah. And who would be, in terms of the sort of bluegrass Americana genre of dobro players, who would be the people you'd look up to the most, say?
Well, Jerry Douglas, of course, is he took the dobro from, it was more like a Hawaiian guitar thing, and it was played lots of double stops and treble stops, and it was had a certain style, the old, and we still use it. But he took it from there and started to play like banjo rolls. Mm. Started to take it in a completely different direction, playing jazz even. Yeah. He's extraordinary. And then there's people like Rob Ikes, who brought it someplace else, and Sally Van Meter, who's a good friend of mine, who bring something of themselves into an instrument that's a very strange instrument. It's tuned to a G, mostly. Mm. Like GBD, GBD, the first, third, and fifth. So it's like playing three strings with one finger, mm-hmm. when you think, because you're using a bar. So it's actually very strange to be able to make it do what it does. And it's such a limited thing, you know. You don't have the chords or the inversions. You don't have any of that. Like, so I don't know how it works. Like, I do it, and I generally don't. People say, oh, yeah, blah, blah, but I think half the time I don't even know what I'm doing, but it seems to work out okay.
Well, it certainly seems in all the lineups that I've heard you perform in, you certainly do seem to know what you're doing. But one of them that I heard you in very recently in this room was when you played with Neil Toner. Oh, how Neil, did you meet Neil, and how did that partnership come to be?
Well, Neil is an extraordinary songwriter and musician. And he had gone over to Nashville to Chris Sewell, who plays with the Dixie Chicks. Mm. And he did an album for him, and he got Rob Ikes to play on it, Rob Ikes. And he came back, and then when he was touring, he didn't have a dobro player, because Rob was giving it loads on it. And so he asked me, will I sit in? And that's a few years back. So I've been gigging with him ever since. Yeah, we were in North Carolina two years ago at the IBMA Festival doing gigs, and it was just wonderful. That whole music, you know, that's extraordinary. The quality of the playing, you just come home with your head down going, oh, Lord.
It's a very depressing thing as a musician to go over there and see the work you still have to do, isn't it?
Yeah, but, I love that. Yeah. I love going to those bands and watching the type of playing that they do. It's just extraordinary how they can create so much music out of 12 notes. You know?
Yeah.
It's unbelievable. And they're just one microphone stepping in and out of this microphone. And every time they return to their play, they do something more extraordinary. Mm-hmm. It's the most wonderful music.
Yeah, it really is.
It really
is. I'm looking forward to hearing you do your take on that genre of music. And really looking forward to hearing your set. And if people want to check you out online, make sure to check out Johnny Gleeson. And for now, enjoy the set.
Thanks. There's a little tune there called The Minstrel Boy. Pretty much everybody knows that. My mom used to sing that to us when we were kids, so I kind of really like those old tunes a lot. So it seems to sit well on the dobro. I'm gonna chance a song from the movie Oh Brother, Where Art Thou? Which is by the Coen brothers, and it's a great movie. So you can all try and name it. And sorrow. I threw the mistakes in for free. So just to talk about the dobro just a little bit, they were invented by the Dopeiro brothers in the 1920s, and they played like a regular guitar, but somebody decided to turn up, raise the action, and play them like a Hawaiian guitar. And it gives it this unique sound. So as a kid, I used to read a lot of Westerns, and I always thought I wanted to be a Texas Ranger. So I'm very attracted to Westerns and cowboy tunes. So I'm going to do a couple of little cowboy tunes. Thank you. There you go. So, try something a little different now on the dobro. This is a hit by Joni Mitchell, I think, back in the 1960s. It was a huge hit. So I thought I'd take a run at this one. A little thing called Clouds. Or Both Sides now, I think it might be known as well. Yeah, something from the 1960s. The O'Carolan tunes I've become very, very fond of. And for over the last while, since the lockdown, I've been listening to an awful lot of his. He must have written some of the greatest tunes ever written. And I've tried to arrange them for the dobro. And I'll probably do a couple here. I'll probably murder a couple of them here. But he was an extraordinary musician. I'm sure people know the history of him. Thank you. was a little thing called Blind Mary. Now, reach over to another dobro here. This is a different tuning. Play another slow tune. This is by Donal Lunny, and it was recorded by Jerry Douglas. It's called A Tribute to Patter O'Donnell. So I'd like to do another O'Carolan tune. This is a little thing called She Beog She Moor. Called She Beog She Moor. Sorry, I hit the mic. Now, I'm probably near the end of my slot here, so I'm just gonna play a little guitar. Huh? This is an Albert Lee song called, I'm gonna attempt to sing this, so I just warn you beforehand.
Morrison card. I'm just a country boy, country boy. I might look like a bank teller, pushing facts in a fire, but I'd rather be a hard caller, to the cut on the stand. Show me where I start, find a horse and cart. I'm just a country boy, country boy at home.
Up next on the Tower Sessions, we have Clive Barnes, who I have listened to for years upon years. And if I remember correctly, one of my very first live performances as a solo artist was opening a gig for you in Carlow.
That's very true, yeah. So Shane's father, who I've known for a long time, told me that his son had taken up guitar and would it be okay if he opened the show? So I thought what were you, 16?
I was 16, yeah.
And I thought, okay, well, Walter's a friend, so that's okay. But I thought it was going to be a 16-year-old kid with a little notebook and, you know, all these little songs
feelings
about how their heart was broken and all of that. And then Shane came out, kind of fully formed. And, yeah, I hate Walter ever since. That was an awful thing to pull on me.
And I've never opened any more of your gigs, have I?
No. I've never played since. This is my first one.
Clive, what was it that got you into the type of music that you play now?
Kind of loads of things, but I don't know. I was always into... I remember when in 1986, I was 10 years old, and a movie called Crossroads came out. It was a movie loosely based on the life of Robert Johnson, the blues guitarist, but it had also had Steve Vai in it, who was a rock guitarist. And I remember seeing that when I was 10 and kind of being blown away by the kind of story of it, you know, and the mysticism about it. And also I had a cousin who gave me a Robert Johnson album, and that was the first blues album I ever heard, and I loved it. And I just always liked that stuff. And, you know, I think about 10 years after that, I started playing acoustic guitar in the style that I play now, so.
Mm-hmm. And I can imagine that there probably weren't a huge amount of people teaching you the style that you play now, in particular, the kind of the lap steel element of what you do.
Yeah.
There's a huge, very obvious blues influence. Was that all self-taught?
Yeah, from listening to records and other old-time kind of musicians and stuff. There was one other lap guitarist in Ireland that did it from time to time, Frankie Lane. Mm. But he made sort of dobro traditional Irish albums, and that was very different than what I wanted to do. And so, yeah, I basically set, like old school, I sat in front of a stereo and, you know, brought the CD back and learned a little piece, and then learned a piece, and it was just like that, because there was no magazines even then. The internet wasn't, you know, the way it is now, so. yeah, it didn't feel difficult at the time to do. I just wanted to do it so much. It just happened.
And I suppose one of the, I've heard you play an awful lot of different kinds of music, but the one that sort of captured me the most because of how different it is the kind of the grunge heavy metal side of you as well, which you'd never guess from watching your live show, but you have this whole other side of you as
well. Some people who only think of me like that, and when they see me doing the other stuff, it's crazy. But I mean, I play in all sorts of different scenarios, different setups. I have another band, which is basically a solo project as well. I've just finished an album in the studio for that. And I mean, music for me is not, it's not one thing, it's everything. Mm-hmm. So I play every style of music that I can possibly do to a level that I think is, you know, okay, and people want to hear, you know, or maybe want to hear.
Yeah. And another thing that I thought I might bring up as well is that you are a multi-instrumentalist. It's not just guitars we're talking about here. I remember getting an album of yours called The Ghost Country, and there's a particular, like, a banjo kind of style track on that that I was obsessed with for a long time. Did that just kind of, was that a natural process, just kind of gravitating onto other instruments?
That was more so out of necessity. I thought that, you know, my own, I was getting very bored with my own sound and my own shows. Mm-hmm. And I thought, like, if I introduce, you know, for three or four songs, I'll bring in a banjo, or I'll bring in, I used to play a one string diddly bow a lot, because I thought, like, you know, why have six strings? You know, you, like, you really only need one. Like, let's not beat around the bush. Like, it's not, it's still making sounds. So, you know, I would do things like that quite a lot, because I think, to my own detriment, I have a bit of a restless spirit when it comes to music. Mm-hmm. I don't really want to settle on one thing, basically.
If people want to find out more about you and all the music that they make, where can they find that?
They probably can't. No, I'm just kidding. You see, this is the problem with being, like, in so many different things. I have a band called Haunted Head. I have my own solo stuff. I'm in some tribute bands, which I enjoy doing, because I get to actually delve into the guitar styles of that act that I like, you know. But, you know, it's basically just YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, all that kind of stuff. Just type my name in and something will come up, you know.
Excellent. Well, listen, I can't wait to hear your set. You want to find out more about Clive, check him out online, Clive Barnes. And for now, enjoy the rest of the set. Thank you.
So that was a song called Kitty Twist. I wrote many years ago. Kitty Twist was a character in a book by a writer called Nelson Algren. And I thought it was a cool name. So I wrote a song about a girl called Kitty Twist who was it's a murder ballad basically. So now I'll do a song for you by a legendary old blues musician called Robert Johnson. This is my interpretation of a song called Crossroad Blues. And it goes like this. Thank you.
Yeah, Putin Bob, if you please.
This next song is this is an old gospel song. I had a little guitar piece that I was just messing around with for a few days, and I was listening to a gospel group called the Swan Silvertones at the time, and I actually had a tour coming up with another band, gospel group called the Blind Boys of Alabama, and I wanted to introduce something a little bit less murder ballad like into my set, so I decided to do a cover version of this Swan Silvertones. It's not their song, but it's where I heard it. It's a song called I Want Jesus to Walk With Me.
Thank you.
Yet I want my Jesus to walk with me. Yet I want my Jesus to walk with me while I'm on that tedious journey. Yeah, while I'm down on that road, while I'm on that tedious journey.
So this next song I'm going to play for you is one I wrote a very long time ago. It took a long time to write this one for loads of different reasons, but one thing happened in the writing of this song. I was on tour in the US one time, and I actually got lost. It was slightly before sat navs became a thing, and I got lost, and I was in a little rental car, and I needed to find somewhere to sleep. So I pulled into what I found out later, it seemed like an abandoned mill to me, but it turns out that it wasn't really abandoned, and I slept in it that night in the car. And when I woke up in the morning, I was surrounded by all these grain trucks, and they were just circling my car. It was kind of a surreal thing. And the lyric in this song kind of references that. So this is called Dust.
Degrees. And he smelled of salt and wet wood, and the rivers all covered with steam. And willow along that bayou, yeah, they drooped their arms, yeah, they drooped their arms in the heat. As though that juice had been baked, as though that juice had been baked from their leaves. And he turned their key, and the car choked into life. Crossing the railway tracks, a circle in the green elevators, railway trucks lined up delivering their load.
So this next song is a song called Lawn Dogs, and there was a movie many years ago called Lawn Dogs, which I loved, but that didn't trigger the title of the song. I was on tour with a musician friend of mine one time, and he told me, he was an American guy, and he told me that, we talked about that movie, but he told me he was an actual lawn dog, which I don't think we have over here, where every summer he would... he would go and mow the lawns of all his neighbors and everybody in his town and get paid for it. And that's how he bought, you know, guitars and different things when he was a young guy. And so this song is about mowing lawns. This next song is a song that I adapted from an old banjo song from a Kentucky banjo player called Doc Boggs. And it's called Danville Girl. Mind is on that girl, wherever she may be. Thank you. Last song. So this is my final song. I'd like to thank the Tara Sessions and Walter and all the crew here for giving me this opportunity, and all the other musicians as well. God knows when we'll be back to playing, and these things are very much welcome. As a full-time musician, definitely I need it, and others do too. Also, we need to thank the Department of Tourism, Culture, Arts, Gaeltacht, Sports and Media for funding these shows. And I'll dedicate this song to Catherine Martin. Thank you very much.
Still won't have it long.
before my time has come. Lonely if I shouldn't die.
Thank you.